It is a pleasure to exist here, now, with you, Dr. Sagan.
Thank you so much.
What is your perception on the utterly unique probability of your existence?
My view is, first of all, it's not our job to impose our wishes or fears on the universe. Our job is to understand what the universe is really like.
How do you go about determining what the universe is really like when you are the universe perceiving itself?
Well, you would think we should be over it, but we still are battling, at least in the United States, the conceit that humans are separate from the rest of nature, that an unbridgeable gap separates humans from the other plants and animals, that we are the particular beneficiaries of the concern of the creator of the universe more than any of the 10 million other species of plants and animals on the earth, when in fact all of our vaunted uniqueness turns out to be shared with other animals, especially with chimpanzees, our closest relatives, with whom we share 99.6% of our hereditary material.
The perception of unifying humanity with nature and the rest of the universe is critical. However, this does not diminish the utter uniqueness, glory, and preciousness of human existence. You mention the idea of a creator. Humanity has been sufficiently shaped by its belief in something outside of itself. Is this system of thought something which you subscribe to?
It's very tempting. I mean, we want to be thought of as children being cared for by an omnipotent, omniscient, and benevolent creator. I mean, think of all the uncertainties and turmoil and terrors of our life, which would be made less terrifying if this were true. But here, if anywhere, is a case where we must not believe because we want it to be true.
It is important to distinguish the idea of believing in something from the idea of subjectively or objectively knowing something to be true. For instance, humanity's objective knowingness of some sort of bioevolutionary system, and humanity's subjective knowingness of hyperdimensional states of consciousness, or the source of existence.
Now, if you take a look at Darwin, you see a case where it was so tempting to say, I find a watch, it requires a watchmaker. Watches do not spontaneously self-assemble. And now I find an acorn, or a squid, or a bacterium. It is much more intricately and exquisitely put together than a watch. Here too there must have been a creator. It's very natural.
Indeed, it is a very natural process for the psyche to perceive the universe as something to be created. The fractal nature of the cosmos inherently imbues consciousness with the idea of being a created creator.
But what Darwin pointed out is that there is a perfectly reasonable process, which is inevitable, which will create enormous, exquisite order out of chaos, given enough time. If we thought the universe was only 6,000 years old, there is not enough time, and evolution is nonsense. But if, as in fact is now definitively true, the solar system and the Earth are 4.5 billion years old, then there's plenty of time for evolution, and our sense that order means creator is wrong.
The universe's dynamics are clearly defined by a vast array of parameters and mechanics, which dictate its functionality and evolutionary mechanisms. The origin of such functionality is not clearly defined, especially from our seemingly fragmented states of existence. Given enough time, such a set of parameters can generate self-interacting and self-organizing systems, which contain feedback loops of varying degrees of intelligence. What are your thoughts on the Planck scale substratum and the origin of matter having a connection to consciousness as a feedback creation mechanism?
Finally, you can say, look, you can go back as far as you want, but somehow the stuff of the universe had to come from somewhere, and isn't that what God did? But that's only true if the universe was created. If the universe was always here, if the universe was infinitely old, then there's nothing for a creator to do. Most of us would be surprised to hear that the universe is going to end one day. We expect the universe to go on forever into the future. Why do we have the idea that it doesn't go on forever into the past? I'm not saying I know the answer to this. This is one of the deepest questions. We do not know the answer. We simply have to keep an open mind. All of us, philosophers, scientists, religious people, no one, in fact, knows.
With existence being infinite, everything has always existed and will continue to exist eternally in one hyperdimensional form or another. However, the present moment of our collective experiences is, in a sense, being existentially instantiated. The infinite expressions of existence function on the basis that everything which exists is inherently contributing to the creation of all other aspects of existence. Saying the universe was created from a single instantiating source, without including each portion of the so-called created universe as a part of the single instantiating source, is illogical. Each portion of existence, be it physical or quasi-physical, is inherently contributing to the creation and evolution of all other aspects of existence. The so-called creator includes you as a portion of the infinite, hyperconscious singularity. Thank you for making my acquaintance, Dr. Sagan.
It's a pleasure to be here. Thank you.